Okay, so we're going to begin with our presentation. First, I'd like to draw your attention to some resources. Hopefully, you can all see my screen right now. And I always have to check that I've logged out of Facebook. Okay, good. Yep, my Facebook page is closed. And the webpage I did want to bring your attention to is our Cornell High Tunnel webpage. Real simple address, hightunnels.cals.cornell.edu. And there's a number of things going on here. We try to post relevant videos. Here's a video that's actually directly related to the topic we're going to get into today that NOFA New York produced. And it has us walking around some high tunnels. This may be the farm that we tour in April if you come visit us in Geneva. And so check out this webpage if you get a chance. Not only do we have videos and all the latest information, it also features my Twitter feed. So no matter where you are in the state, you can find out what's going on in the high tunnel world in terms of education programs. For example, if you look at this, we have join us tonight in Jamestown, New York for a high tunnel session at 6 o'clock. So if you're in this part of the state and you come visit the page, you'd find out about all those sorts of things. We also have a lot of resources on here as well. For example, if you're interested in growing vegetables in high tunnels, and let's say you want to grow tomatoes, you click on this and we have all kinds of great resources on those, including IPM resources, but structures, trellising, etc. I hope you'll check that out if you get a chance. And also economics. A lot of people have questions on economics in high tunnels, and we have some good resources there as well. So check that out if you get a chance. Now, what Betsy asked me to speak about today is fertility challenges. And so last week, Neil Mattson gave us a fantastic in-depth look at managing fertility and other issues in container-based production. I'm trying to get some more light. And in some ways, there are some advantages to growing inside of containers. And one is that you can assume that the media is generally not going to make a large nutritional contribution to the crop in general, aside from what we add to it. The challenge with growing in the soil in a heated greenhouse or an unheated high tunnel or anything else is that that soil can act as a reservoir for nutrients over time, and we run into some challenges. So we're going to get into that. So where does these challenges come from? Well, we have to look at the system as it is somewhat enclosed, and we have this plastic and steel that excludes rainwater and snow, precipitation, from entering the soil. So we lose some important contributions that precipitation makes to our soils, and that we have no leaching of that soil profile. And since we've spent money on plastic and steel, we want to maximize the productivity of this economically. And so oftentimes vegetable crops get grown time and time again. And this leads to disease problems being in that soil in particular. This is a photo I took of some tomato roots this November. This is not a common disease in New York. This is corky root rot. And this is a soil-borne fungus that infects at cool temperatures. And it's not an easy disease to get rid of. So by growing in the soil year after year after year, we end up getting ourselves into some major disease issues. And I have good news. The good news is that next week, Brian and Amy are going to talk about high tunnel vegetable diseases. Why is that good news? That means I don't have to talk about it. That's why it's good news. But the principle is the same with fertility and diseases is that the intensive year after year use of that soil gets us into problems, whether it's biological or abiotic. This is a video I wanted to share, but the sound isn't working on it. These are some high tunnel growers in Delaware County in New York. You can see some high tunnels with a tremendous amount of spinach being grown. And what this video is here to show, if this audio would have worked on it, is that the growers' approach to fertility oftentimes is not based on sound knowledge or information. So the growers have a general idea of how they want the crop to grow, and they throw a lot of fertility at it. In this case, it was a compost and chicken manure. And I said, how do you calculate how much chicken manure to put on? And the response was that, well, we find something that looks semi-official on the internet, and then we calculate how much nitrogen is in the chicken manure, and then we apply that, and then we double the rate because we want to be sure that we have a very good crop. So the challenge is using something that's semi-official looking and at the same time doubling the actual application rate, because if a little bit is good, then a little bit more is even better. But that really has become a major problem in high tunnels across the state. So somewhere around 4 years ago, a group of us began an intensive sampling of high tunnel soils across all of New York State. And so we have worked with over 40 farms in northern part of the state, Hudson Valley, Finger Lakes, Western New York, any place we can get to. And it includes conventional growers, as we see here. This is a conventional high tunnel with high yields, heavy fertility. It includes organic settings. It includes urban sites. This is in the Finger Lakes of New York. This is a high tunnel on an urban farm in Buffalo, New York. And the high tunnel is run by refugees from Nepal. And this woman with a baby, a young woman on her back, is taking care of some tomatoes as well as some other specialty crops inside of that high tunnel. And what we've done is, across all that diverse spectrum of production styles and management styles, collected soil samples. So here's my coworker, Cordelia Hall, collecting a soil sample at one of our cooperating farms. So we collect all of those soil samples and have entered them and continue to enter them into a database. We've been doing this now. We're at least into our fourth year of this. So we have a tremendous amount of data on what's going on inside of high tunnel soils over time. Some of these are heated, some of them are not. The common theme is that they're all soil-based. So we collect those soil samples in the spring and in the fall. And then in season, what we do is collect foliar samples of what's going on inside the crop. And tomatoes are by far the most common crop that we're working with, although we do work with some other crops as well. So the information I'm going to share with you today is what comes from that project. Amy is on the call with us today. She's an important contributor to that project as well. So what are the challenges we see? Well, the most common problem is that nutrient deficiencies are often overcorrected. And the truth is deficiencies are much more rare than excess fertility. The two nutrients of concern in particular are phosphorus and calcium. So fertilizers, whether they're conventional or organic, tend to elevate our soil EC, which you should have learned from Neil Mattson last week what EC means. Let's check the chat capabilities here. What does EC mean? Let's see if someone can type that into the chat.
And meanwhile, Brian said, remember the disease session is not next week, but in 2 weeks. Next week we have some production factors covered by Amy.
Oh, very good. Thanks for the correction.
And then Jen Stengel said, is that statewide? I think meaning the overcorrection of deficiencies, or were more areas, or some areas worse, referring to the P, the phosphorus and the calcium?
Well, so great question, Jen. So the issue tends not to be localized too much, because it's really about what is the grower putting into the soil more than anything. So some soils particularly are going to be high in calcium. We do have naturally high calcium soils in certain parts of the state compared to others. And so they're going to get into an excess situation sooner. But the management is more the issue than the actual parent material. So what is EC? That one is still lingering. Anyone know what EC? Okay.
Jen said that's great. We don't have an answer for EC yet.
Oh, come on, people.
Oh, Lily says electrical conductivity. Paul says micro, whatever you call those things, per square centimeter. Conductivity, TDS, salts.
Yes. And so every one of those answers is correct. Electrical conductivity is what the EC stands for. And that's measured in micromoles per square centimeter, I guess. I just say micromoles, but yeah, that sounds right. Conductivity. TDS. Yeah, it stands for total dissolved solids, and so that is often a shortcut to getting EC, because obviously your salts are a solid, and so then Lily wraps it up nicely by saying salts. So yes, what we see are salts going up over time, and we measure that generally in electrical conductivity. So an important tip, when you are working with high tunnel soils, if you're working with the Agri-1 lab, for that sample, add on what they call a soluble salts test. It's $5 more to have that test, but it's very important when we're working with high tunnels to get that EC test done. So fertilizers, composts, and irrigation water in particular raise the pH of our soil. So we have high phosphorus, high calcium, high electrical conductivity, and high pH. Okay, so why does that matter? Of course, it's affecting our yield and quality of whatever we're growing. So I want to talk about two important concepts with irrigation water in particular. So if we think about this high tunnel, there is no rainwater, and whatever we're putting through the drip irrigation system that we're using to irrigate the crop, we're using drip irrigation, not overhead watering. Hopefully that's clear. Is very concentrated, particularly in that plant's root zone. And since there's no additional precipitation, the root zone of the crop is very narrow. It is going to stay just where we place that water. So whatever's going on in that root zone is more amplified than it would be in a field setting, where you would have natural precipitation in the row middles and give the roots some opportunity to explore soil outside of the actual band of fertigation or irrigation. So most of the irrigation water, if not all of the irrigation water that we test through this program in New York State, is high in these two things: pH, which hopefully we all understand, a scale of basic to neutral to acid, as well as alkalinity. Alkalinity is different from pH, although it's closely linked. Alkalinity is a measurement of bicarbonates, and I imagine Neil covered this last week. But the alkalinity can also be thought of as a form of liquid lime, because the most common bicarbonate is calcium bicarbonate. And so we are adding, in a sense, we are liming our soils every time we turn on our irrigation water. And why does that matter? Well, as the alkalinity rises in that root zone, the pH rises as well. And we all hopefully are familiar with this chart that shows that as the pH rises, all of our plant nutrients, most of our plant nutrients, become less available. So we hope to be somewhat on the acid side inside of our high tunnels. So I'm going to share. Go ahead, Elizabeth or Betsy.
Make a point. Neil showed the similar scale last time, just so people remember, but if they go and compare them, this is the one that's for soil, and the one that he showed last week was for media, and they vary.
So, okay. Thanks for sharing that. That's a good point. Yeah. I'll be honest with you. I grabbed this one off the internet probably a year or two ago. So the point being that our pH, as it gets higher, is going to make nutrients less available. And I want to show you, how does this play out in real life? This is, hopefully you're seeing this now. This is something I was working on this morning with, the farm happens to be in Ohio, but this farm sent me their water analysis and wanted me to talk with them about what they could do to improve their high tunnel production. So one of the first things we do is we look at, well, here's a pH of 7.6. We've got a problem there. Okay. And then the other thing I'm going to jump down to is all the way at the bottom. Our alkalinity is 175 parts per million. And so that's a real life setting. I just happen to have these files still open on my desk because it was the last thing I was doing before this webinar. And then I go to their soil sample, and their soil pH is 6.4. Okay, so that is actually not that bad. But knowing what we do know about high tunnels, we can begin to make some recommendations based on people's water and soil samples. So that's the key, one of the first keys to managing soils in protected environments is knowing what's going on there, having a soil test and having a water test as well. This is a private lab. This is A&L. We work with a private lab too. We work with Agri-1 in Ithaca, which is my preferred lab. So moving into the data that we've begun to collect on these high tunnels across the state, what we do is, in this case, we have averaged foliar nitrogen levels of our crop. So we're taking the foliar samples of the crop and then chart that across the spectrum of pHs that we had in this project, 6.2 all the way up to 7.7. Real quick review on foliar samples. So the foliar sample is a tissue sample. It's also called a tissue sample. We take the youngest fully expanded leaf, which in the case of tomatoes is somewhere around 5 from the top. And then we send that into a lab, and then they send back the percent dry matter or parts per million, depending on the nutrient, in the plant to us. And we have known ranges for what's acceptable. Amy and I also had a conversation with Neil about how to properly sample. Because last week Neil said in the case of the tomatoes, you take simply the terminal leaflet, just a single leaflet off of that entire compound leaf. Whereas our practice has always been to take the entire compound leaf itself. And it looks like either approach is okay. The three of us put our heads together on it and concluded that actually either approach is okay. But if you take the entire compound leaf, you're going to spend a lot less time sampling because you fill up the sample bag much quicker than taking those individual leaflets. Any questions on that? Okay, I'm going to take a drink of water. Thank you. Okay, so for nitrogen, you want to be somewhere between 4 and 5% of the foliar mass of that dry matter inside the leaf. And the green bar on this chart represents the upper limit, and the lower level is a deficiency. And you can see that there's not a big difference if we do an average of those pHs across all the high tunnels. But if we take away the average and then we plot out the individual samples of each farm and each site, you see this trend a little bit more clearly, that these black dots showing the overall trend line, that as our pH rises, we dip below acceptable ranges of nitrogen in the plant. So a real quick conclusion here is that not watching our soil pH leads to nitrogen deficiency in tomatoes. Why is that a problem? Well, when we run out of nitrogen, we make a lot less flowers and we have a lot less fruit. Now let's look at calcium levels. We can do the same thing. Put nitrogen on the y-axis and then look at all of the sites moving from a lower level of around 2,500 pounds of calcium per acre all the way up to 16,000 or 8 tons of calcium per acre. And as we increase calcium, you'll see that nitrogen becomes less available to the plant in general. There's no need to have all that excess calcium. And when our irrigation water is high in calcium bicarbonate, this is what's going on, is that we are adding calcium in the form of liquid lime to the root zone. This goes against what a lot of fertilizer companies are telling the people that we work with. There's a lot of myths out there around the role of calcium in plant nutrition. Calcium is oftentimes referred to as the nutrient that makes other nutrients available. And you can see certainly here in the case of calcium, the opposite is true. Okay, Lily makes a quick question here. What plant stage is best for taking foliar samples? Great question, Lily. So we begin sampling. Number one, we don't sample one time per season. We'd like to sample about a half a dozen times per season in the case of tomatoes. Probably a little bit less so if you're looking at a winter crop. And so that first sample, we want to make sure that we are measuring what's going on in the soil and not what went on in the transplant stage of the plant. So we wait until that plant has produced a fully mature leaf after it's been transplanted into the soil, unless you're really curious about how good of a job you did growing a transplant. So that's when we begin. We begin a few weeks after transplanting, maybe 2 to 3 weeks post-transplant, and then we stay on a 2 to 3 week cycle, backing off sometime usually in the fall, usually in September, and we're shooting for around half a dozen samples per farm. So moving forward. Okay. So.
Nope, we're not seeing it yet.
Not seeing anything? Sorry, my PowerPoint froze there. Let me try that again. Okay. There we're yep. Live again. Good. Okay, thank you.
See pictures of tomatoes.
Yeah, ugly tomatoes, right? Yeah. So this is blossom end rot, which we almost always blame on water, not insufficient water to transport calcium to the plant. In this case, what's going on is that there is an abundance of calcium in the soil, right? There's an excess of calcium in general. But in this very cool soil, the plants are being forced, in this case, the grower's case, they're forcing a lot of soluble nitrogen through the drip, causing a lot of vegetative growth. Well, that vegetation needs calcium to grow as well. And so the vegetation is at this point competing with the fruit for calcium. And in this case, we had a form of blossom end rot that's called internal blossom end rot, which can be a little bit hard to figure out. It starts on the side of the fruit, kind of in a ring around the growing point. So moving forward with potassium, one of the scary things now, potassium, the desired levels are between 3.5% and 4% dry matter. And if you look at the average groupings by soil pH being on the x-axis, what's scary is almost everyone that we sampled is consistently low on potassium. And potassium is critical for fruit quality as well as many other things within the plant. So that's kind of the scary takeaway here, is that in general, people are not getting enough potassium to their plants. And we break apart the averages and just simply plot the individual samples. You'll see that as our pH goes up, this line drops further below deficiency as I move from a more acid to a more alkaline soil over time. So this is the trend we're seeing in those, across those 40 farms across the state. Decreasing levels of potassium as time goes on because people add too much calcium to their soil. Those previous two slides were showing pH. Now we look at soil calcium. which of course is closely tied to pH, and it's the same trend. In general, people are lower than you need to be for potassium, and the higher we go with calcium, the less potassium we have available. Now, moving away from our macronutrients to a micronutrient, in this case, manganese, which is abbreviated MN, is a very good indicator nutrient for pH, and it shows a steeper curve for availability as we move across those sample sites. And manganese is reported in parts per million. The previous slide said percent. This one says parts per million. Parts per million is the correct unit. And so manganese in particular, if you're new to working with tomatoes in in-ground settings, this is a common deficiency that you'll learn to recognize over time. But what we, it starts with a, it's a real bright marginal, bright yellow chlorosis on the margins of the leaves about midway up the plant, and then it'll eventually become necrotic. But the key is we want to catch these problems before they become visible. And that's why we soil, that's why we foliar sample, so that we can catch the problems ahead of time. Okay, I'm gonna pause for a second, and how about we open it up for questions? I can't hear you, Betsy.
I have to remember which one I'm doing. Paul said, it looks like EC is reported in millimoles rather than micro. They're one millimoles is 1,000 micro, okay, which I would consider a fairly high reading. What's the threshold for concern?
Okay, we look at, I look at EC, electrical conductivity, which they measure in, let's go back to one of these, to that sample. Let's see here. So yeah, here is the conductivity on this, on this analysis is millimoles per centimeter, and it's 1.0. And you can see here that they have the desired range of 0.75. So in this case, they're above. Now that scale, as I understand it, goes like from 0 to 9. And you, when you conduct a literature review of that, you will see that some plants have tolerances going all the way up to 5, 6, 7, 8, et cetera. But our experience is that the effects of salts are usually subtle. Does that make sense? So you're generally seeing decreased yields over time in relation to climbing levels of salts, but there's not a single threshold where all of a sudden the plants turn brown. And the other problem is that as those, as that EC climbs, generally there's so many other problems that are going on as well, including all the pH and calcium stuff that I just went over, and all these the biological problems that are going over. You're probably increasing your nematodes. There's probably some root zone pathogens that are increasing in there as well. So our general message is the lower the better when it comes to EC. Questions or comments?
And you're talking about the EC in the soil solution at that point.
I'm looking at the soil solution. Occasionally, when we test water, we tend to look mainly at the pH and the alkalinity. There are some people that have naturally high salts in their water. They're generally, looking, their total dissolved solids will come back high. Getting salt out of water is, as I think we all know, very expensive and wasteful. So reverse osmosis is really the only viable option for removing salt in an irrigation setting, and really not practical. If you have a high salt water, you should probably consider an alternative water source, is my experience. Okay. So I don't know if anyone ever sees ads like this on social media, you know, like one weird trick to lose your gut, one weird trick to regrow your hair, things like this. Maybe I'm the only one who sees those things, but the point I'm trying to make here is that there is such a thing as chelated manganese. There are foliar applications of potassium, and there are all sorts of quick fixes for these problems. But the true root problem is to lower the pH of the soil so that the manganese is available. Steve Reiner tells us that we need really very little manganese on a per acre basis, and most soil tests come back somewhere between 10 and 50 pounds. If you go above 70 pounds per acre of manganese, you can run into a toxicity situation. And so if we apply a chelated foliar manganese, when you do the math on the rate, it comes down to teaspoons per greenhouse structure, per say 3,000 square feet. You're looking at one or two teaspoons, and you can very easily burn things. So it becomes a very touchy situation when you're making a recommendation to a grower to correct one of these micronutrient deficiencies, because they can burn plants, and then they burn all that foliage browns back, and then you get into a botrytis problem, which Brian and Amy will talk about in 2 weeks, not one, but 2 weeks from now. We'll talk about diseases. So the real solution is to drop that root zone pH. And Betsy and anyone else who works in ornamentals knows this very well. If you're growing, say, a crop like petunias or calabricoa in a hanging basket, what happens if you don't drop your pH in your irrigation water? You get an iron deficiency. Not because the iron's not there. There's you can provide all the iron you want, but if you don't drop the root zone of those the root zone pH of those crops, you're going to run into deficiencies. Now, I want you to pay attention to the next few slides, looking at the soil phosphorus levels in some of these high tunnels, and this is very important as you go forward and work with growers. Or even if it's home gardeners, it doesn't matter. But pay attention to the phosphorus and the pH on the soil samples. So here's my phosphorus. Is there a pen? Yeah, cool. Here's a pen. Here's my phosphorus. It's 2. Here is my soil pH. It is 6.5. I'm just learning to use the pen here, forgive me. Okay. Now as I move forward, that phosphorus now is 21 pounds. And look at what the soil, the bars show on the chart. So this thing froze on me again. Sorry about that.
There you go.
Okay, so phosphorus is 21 pounds and it's very high. Yeah, just every so often this PowerPoint will lock up. I'm sorry.
Technology. There you go.
Yeah, sorry. Okay. Hopefully this will work this time. So at 21 pounds, I'm very high. And at 2, I was low. So where is the optimum? The optimum is somewhere between 2 and 20, right? So it's not very much. That's pounds per acre. So at 21 pounds, I'm very high. Okay. So now imagine you're working with someone and they're at 21 pounds. And then as time goes on, they continue to fertilize with, say, a triple 20 or a compost. And now you're at 130 pounds and you're still very high. And you're still very high at 182 pounds. Your pH now is 7.5. And now you're at 700 pounds.
Is this the same farm over time?
This is not. Several of them are, but this is the trend that we're seeing. Okay. And the message is to the educators here today is that, remember, at 20 pounds, the paper, the 8.5 by 11 piece of paper that the grower gets said I was high. So there's about 6 inches of space there to represent that bar of being very high at 20 pounds. And if I'm also very high at 600 pounds, I would need a piece of paper 15 feet wide to represent the difference between those two, even though they're still simply called very high. It's alarmingly high, but we're restricted in the way that we communicate the information. So this is why you have to pay attention to the numbers and not just the bars. The paper just simply, as it represents phosphorus, cannot communicate how high people are getting. Now look at the soil pH, is 7.8. Okay, so why does it matter? Plants need phosphorus, that's right. But as phosphorus goes up, when we go back to our foliar tests, we find that potassium levels go down. That is the general trend. And you can see something very scary on this chart, which is that we have some tests coming in at 1,100 and 1,200 pounds of phosphorus per acre. At this point, it would probably be more profitable for the farmer to begin mining phosphorus and selling it back to the fertilizer company. We need somewhere around 10 to 15 pounds per acre, not 1,000 pounds. And the problem is we're restricting the uptake of other nutrients when that phosphorus gets out of hand. And so here's an example of that. We're into a potassium deficiency on the top leaf here, and then a magnesium deficiency on the lower leaf. And that translates into poor fruit quality. Any questions? Okay. So how do we deal with this? Well, there's a number of ways. I'm going to go back to my, are you still seeing my screen?
Yep.
I'm going to go back to my High Tunnel webpage here and show you one option. And that is to have a movable High Tunnel. These things are very popular. This is one that a student designed in Ithaca. It was an engineering student who was working at the student-run organic farm called Dillman Hill. And you can see that this thing rolls on rails. And so they can move it in between these two different growing pads, in a sense. We'd like to, at some point, have a meeting to showcase how this was constructed. And so now, what are the benefits of having that? Well, that means that half of that growing site is getting precipitation every year, so that's good. It means that we can do some cover cropping, and that's very good too. So that is one option, movable high tunnels. Movable high tunnels, I am not the biggest proponent of those because they're very fragile. They're more susceptible to weather damage than non-movable high tunnels. And my experience is that most people who start out with a movable high tunnel end up turning it into a non-movable high tunnel over time because they get frustrated with just how unstable the structure is. But there is, without argument, some advantages to soil management there. So getting back to Lily's question earlier in the presentation, when do we begin sampling? Well, here we have, this is a cooperating farm in Orleans County where we began sampling on June 12th. And it looks like we took 5 samples and we ended in mid-August. And we can look at nitrogen in the first column, phosphorus, potassium, magnesium, calcium, and sulfur. So what those 6 nutrients have in common is that they're all measured on a percent. So even though magnesium, calcium, sulfur aren't considered macronutrients, they are secondary nutrients, and their levels are in the same ballpark as, say, nitrogen or phosphorus or potassium. And so here we have a solid green bar and solid red bar, dotted green and dotted red, showing acceptable ranges of the nutrients in the vegetative stage and the fruiting stage of growth, in this case for tomatoes. And you can see a real common trend here which is that nitrogen starts out very high, but then it tends to go down as time goes on. But the potassium, this was an even more common trend, is that that one, the third column from the left, is tanking to below acceptable levels later in the season. And so that's where we lose flowers, and that's where we lose our fruit quality as well. All the while, calcium, if you'll notice, is having a party over here. Okay, real common set of trends. Here's a sample from Ulster County. And what is fun to see with these foliar charts, we started in this one in May and went to August 1st. You can see when the farmer actually opens their mail, because you see these spikes, say, look at nitrogen. There's an overall trend, and then certainly some nitrogen entered into the system in a soluble form and spiked upwards right there and around June 25th, and then spiked downwards again. And you can see that probably at the same time that they applied nitrogen, they also applied potassium, right? Because there's that perfect V shape of decreasing potassium and then spiking. So the problem here is that the farmer's using the foliar test, but they're using them too reactively, too late. So we need to probably be more regular in the foliar sampling and hopefully even those curves out a little bit. Okay, I've got about 10 minutes left. So I'm going to just illustrate some other charts that show similar trends. For organic farms, in particular.
So I'm just going to interrupt you again, Jud. So we'll put the whole PowerPoint. We can put the whole PowerPoint up on Box if you want, or you can.
Yeah, I'm fine. I'm fine with that. Yep, okay. That's and we'll get that way up. If people want to spend more time on slides that I skip, they can. Here's a real common nitrogen trend, particularly on organic farms. And they start out high because a lot of that nitrogen is pre-incorporated and there's less soluble materials available. And I'm sure Neil covered this in detail. And so you just have a general overall downward trend of nitrogen over time. This is a common trend on conventional farms. Nitrogen starts out high, but then gets on a seesaw again as people are responding to foliar tests. Now, here is hopefully a little bit better curve. We still don't want to start out that high because you're favoring so much vegetative growth, but at least we're staying within acceptable levels on an ongoing basis there. So for organic fertility in tunnels, we do want to pre-incorporate as much as we can because we have less soluble materials available to us. That can be for nitrogen, soy, alfalfa, feather, or blood meal. We tend not to favor manure because of high salt levels. Sulfate of potash is a certified organic material, and I made the point that almost every farm we work with struggles with potash. So the addition of sulfate of potash is good. We have almost no one that we work with that needs to add phosphorus. So I won't say anything further about that. So how do we apply these things? Well, again, if we are measuring the nutrient levels of our soils, if we're measuring the pH, alkalinity, and salts of our water, we should also measure the nutrient levels of any compost that we add as well. So once we know what that is, then we can calculate how much to add. And generally, it's a very fine layer of manure that you want to work with, or compost, I mean to say. So here's my good friend Nelson Hoover. I always like to point out that it was nice of him not to turn on the beaters there as I was filming this. But he's putting out a very light layer of compost, and we've tested this compost so we know how much calcium is in there, and as well as our NPK and everything else. And this is a fully composted, this is a digested dairy manure. But if we don't know what is in that compost, we are more than likely going to be over applying. So there's an important part of this that we have not addressed, and I'd like to address at some point moving forward, if I can find someone to pay me to do it, which is to look at more of the biology of what is going on in these soils. So here we have a cover crop in the wintertime, and we have studied in detail the plant nutrition and the soil nutrition, and we're continuing to develop best management practices for farmers around those topics. What is the role of soil biology in maintaining health and nutrition in our crops over time inside the high tunnel? So traditionally, someone who's growing a summertime crop would leave the high tunnel completely fallow in the wintertime. So one of our questions is, what if we plant a cover crop to keep that, number one, keep the root zone, the soil, moist over the wintertime, not saturated, but moist, so that there can be some biology there. And there's a root, there's a rhizosphere. There's an opportunity for microorganisms to continue to interact with plant roots. And hopefully that's going to help us with nutrient cycling over time. And that's something we want to look at more in the future. We don't understand it very well just yet. For those of you who are on social media, I encourage you to...
We just lost your Twitter address there.
Lost my Twitter address. Let's get that up on the share screen. I don't want you to follow the wrong Jud Reid on Twitter.
Because there are others.
I'm sure there are, but for better or worse, there's only one me. Betsy and I are friends on Twitter, right?
We're, you can follow each other.
Yep. So there I am. You're welcome to try to keep up with me there. So can we do questions and thoughts?
You certainly can. It says, we've got one from Jim that says, so are you irrigating then in winter on the cover crop?
Great question, Jen. So that cover crop, we really only irrigate it to establish it. And this farm, the water source is strong enough that we actually try to leach out that soil profile with a sprinkler. With a sprinkler system, we will run for really an extended period of time till that soil is fully saturated. And then we will seed this cover crop over top of it. And the cover crop, right now we're working with the winter grains because they're what's hardy enough to germinate after a tomato crop.
So any other questions? If you want to unmute yourself and ask them directly, you can do that, or you can write them in chat. Have you had any growers voicing concerns about the FSMA rules cramping their soil fertility management routine? So that's food safety. The post-digester manure application made me think about this. No data exists regarding pathogen survival.
Yeah, great question, Paul.
That I know.
Yeah, you're right. I think the challenge there is that that you're actually hinting at is that the space between crops in a high tunnel is either is smaller or non-existent compared to what it is in the field. And so the issue of how much time you need between a manure application and when you can harvest, I think is 120 days. And so a lot of times we're growing a crop within 120 days in there again. So it is a challenge, and it's another reason not to use manure. That I would guess that post-digester manure, you might know more than I do, but I would guess that they would have to test that for E. coli. I would sure hope that they would.
Any other questions coming? And you know, you can always send questions through on the listserv. The listserv that we created for this project works. You're all able to post. So if you have questions, post them on listserv. Judd's on it, Amy's on it, Brian's on it, I'm on it, and Bart Neal's on it, and each other, because often we find that people within the group have a lot of knowledge also. So feel free to post any questions you have there too.
Yeah.
How are your growers rotating crops? Tomato, tomato can't be good.
You're very perceptive, Lily. It's not good. So the rotation is weak. And the problem is that if it is a rotation, it tends to be with peppers or eggplants or cucumbers, none of which are true rotations. Cucumbers, in a sense, they're not solanaceous, but they're still a vegetable and they still share a lot of the common insect pests in particular. So if they do rotate, it tends to be between vegetables. And I would like to get more to this situation of what we have here of actually getting a crop in there, and ideally for more than 1 year. So in the end, people often want to do that. So they say, well, to do that, I really need to plant, I need to have more than one high tone because I can't give up the income that my tomatoes generate. So then they plant that second high tunnel with the idea of rotation. But then a cucumber crop grows into that second high tunnel, and then a pepper crop grows into it. And then they just have two high tunnels that they're rotating between vegetable families, but it's not an effective rotation for soil health, in my opinion.
Give people a little time to type if they're feeling like typing. And meanwhile, thank everyone for coming. It's great to have this number of people, and I think we get good questions and good, not exactly discussion maybe, but at least some good input on the topic. We'll post the recorded webinar on the box files, and also we'll post the PowerPoint when Jud sends it to me. And that way you can watch some of those videos that are in there that we couldn't really show very well. And we'll be getting some other resources too. But also make the point that if you find something that you think is great, let me know or post it in box yourself, because the box is also open for anyone to post in.
Yeah, and I realize now that I didn't do a good job describing possibly where to send foliar samples or how to do that. And so that's another resource that we can add to the box, Betsy.
Okay, that's great, because Neil did have some labs listed, and we put up a post of that. But
okay, good.
We can have more input in with it, because everyone has a different point of what they like about different labs. And Jen mentions how to sample fact sheet, and we can find that also. The other thing, too, is I would like to find, and I don't know if it exists, is something that sort of tells you what are the recommended levels. You had a nice, on those graphs, it's nice, it shows the maximum and then the minimum vegetative and the minimum for fruiting. And that information is sometimes hard to find. So you have it all for tomato. Resources on that would be great too.
Yeah, it would be. What Cordelia Hall gets the credit there in that she actually went through several of the resources, because there are some differences in what different people say are acceptable. And so we tried to look at what were the most commonly reported ranges for some of those. But yeah, that is always a good resource to have.
And also to know that when you're getting information from a lab, they don't all do the test the same way. So sometimes if you look at one versus another, they look totally different, but that's because they measure them differently.
Yeah. And so Jen is asking, why doesn't the report have that range built into the chart? The labs that I work with do have that built in, Jen. So I work with, for the foliar samples, I don't work with Agri One. I may give them a shot this year. I've spoken with their people recently, but I work with a private lab on that, and they do show me where each sample is coming in for acceptable and deficient.
But again, sometimes it's like you were saying, you get that bar graph that says it's, you know, too low or too high, but that doesn't necessarily tell you anything. And so sometimes what it's nice to see is numbers associated with a methodology. So.
Yep.
We're at 1 o'clock, so we can still take questions or comments, but it's also time if anyone wants to go. And I think Jud is actually in Chautauqua, and he probably has something else he's supposed to be doing. I'm not sure.
I'll probably get going, but I want to thank everyone for being here today, and in particular Betsy for organizing this and putting together the whole series, as well as the IPM project that we hope as many of you as possible can be involved in here.
It's a team. And Lily wants to know if hardwood mulch steals nutrients. And I think we often assume that it does.
It sure does. There's a lot of carbon in that mulch, right? And so that carbon, the the soil microbes want to break that down, and to break it down, they need nitrogen. So when you add too much carbon, in the case of a hardwood mulch, you can end up with a nitrogen tie-up in the soil as the nutrient, as the microbes compete with the crop for any free nitrogen there.
Great. Thank you very much, Jud. We'll see you next time, hopefully, or we'll see some of you all next time, we hope.
Yep. Okay. Thanks.
On deck next time. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.